First of all, if we try to scan the identity of Syriza United Social Front, we could say that, as it has been a bit described, that Syriza, in a way, is a child of the new social movements. It consists of political organizations, but at the same time, it was born as a child of the social movements. And let me explain this a bit. After the collapse of the so-called real socialist, existing socialist bloc, of course the left of the countries that belong to this bloc felt very bitterly the consequences of this collapse and the delegitimization of the ideas, the principles and the values of the left. Progressive ideas and practices. But this did not affect only the left of these countries, but the global left. So, in a way, the fact that one decade later a number of bigger and smaller left forces decided to overcome their self-isolation, their political marginalization, their sectarianism, and join forces, came out as a result of a common assumption despite our internal differences. The common feeling and the common, let's say, belief that all the historical approaches, all the different historical experiments of the left have failed. And this is the first very crucial question if you want to overcome the previous status and build something new. Why is Syriza, in a way, a child of the social movement? Because Syriza was created after quite a long process of coexistence of various and diverse left and progressive forces in the social movements. And not only in Greece, but, and this is important for our history, also in the level of the international social movements, and especially the social forum process that the anti-global movement created. Through our participation in this process, we contaminated, let's say, our ideas with the notion of building unity through the respect of diversity. Unity through diversity. This is a central part. This is a central and essential material in the attempt to construct a force of unity inside the left. In other words, we decided, being influenced by the practices of the movement and the social forum process, that in order to overcome sectarianism, we need to learn and train ourselves in a process of working together, starting from the very concrete political struggles for very concrete political demands, and then in a step-by-step process to try to enlarge our internal consensus. This is the story of Syriza. We started working together in the various social resistances that have been developed in Greece and internationally, and step by step, we advanced the level of our unity. In 2000-2001, we constructed at first, let's say, a loose political forum of the left. It was called Space for Common Action, Dialogue and Unity of the Left, which was not expressed in an election. But in the beginning, it started discussing the basics. How can we restart? How can we begin a unity process one decade after the defeat of all our theories? And in a step-by-step process, we reached the point of political and electoral unity, very concrete unity, that it was a bit expressed for the first time in the national elections in 2000 with a small cooperation of the party that I belong, which is the biggest party of Syriza, it's called Synaspismos and it means the coalition of the left, with one or two smaller organizations of the radical left. And but then the official first version of Syriza was introduced before the national elections in 2004 as a result of this whole process of unity in action, first of all. Of course, in these years, since 2004 and until today, Syriza had to overcome important internal problems, difficulties, turbulences, disagreements, disappointments, and defeats. We were not always victorious. We managed to make sure that the alternative left remained in the Greek parliament, so the voice of the left, even as a minor opposition, remained alive in the parliament and could be expressed even in the institutional level. But at the same time, we had to face all the difficulties that come up from an original experiment. Because the paradigm of the traditional left has been sectarianism. And the alternative paradigm of unity is something that is very difficult to be built. And that's why it caused all the temporary or more permanent difficulties. There were two reasons for which we managed to overcome these difficulties that we faced from time to time. The first reason is that even in the most difficult moments, there was a mass of people in Syriza that believed that we should rescue the concept of unity through diversity. So no matter if we had even personal traumas among each other, there were people that insisted that this experiment should continue. The second element has to do with what I said in the beginning, that Syriza is a child of the social movements, of the experience in the social movements. That every time we had to pass an internal crisis, there was a developing social movement that changed the atmosphere among our members, that redirected our attention to the real problems and the real fight that the Greek society had to give, and not to problems which in some cases in the internal scene of the left might be problems that do not reflect to real social problems, but have to do with the internal microcosm, micro world of the left. So how does Syriza try to overcome tradition, especially in its relation with the social movements? Our experience in the anti-global movement and the social forum process gave us a very useful lesson. That in order for the left to be efficient in the support and the organization and the participation in social struggles, it should immediately abandon the bankrupt concepts that the traditional left had in previous decades concerning its relation to the social movements. This means that since the very first moment that we united forces and participated in the various movements, we rejected the concept of avant-gardism. We rejected the concept that in order for a social movement to be successful and class-orientated, it should have an avant-garde political party of the working class, controlling it and manipulating from above. This has been one of the main reasons for the devaluation of social movements in all the past decades. And this thing we tried in a step-by-step process of our own maturation, political and militant maturation, to overcome. And I think that we, judging from our position today, we have been quite successful in this. I will give you a very characteristic example that has to do with the 3 years of the crisis. The social movement that changed the political map in our country was the movement of the squares, the occupation of all the major squares of the country last year, that followed, and this is a crucial part of the internationalization that I will answer later, that followed, let's say, the provocation of our Spanish brothers and sisters, when they put out a banner in the occupied squares of Madrid asking Greeks, wake up. So the next week we had the creation of the movement of the squares starting from Athens and Syntagma Square. This movement brought a historical breakthrough since the first day of its birth. It had all the new characteristics that have characterized the social resistances of the last two or three years in Europe and also outside Europe, the States, Northern Africa, and things like that. A spontaneous organization by people with no political affiliation, the extensive use of new technologies for spreading the message and for coordinating people, and also a wide, very popular sense of a rejection of the mainstream political system. The crisis of political representation that has been present in Europe quite a long time now. A rejection of the political establishment that was characterized as the main responsible for the dramatic condition that the Greek society is experiencing today. So the question that was put to the left forces, the various left forces, not only us, in the first day of this movement, was naturally what will be the approach of the left with this movement. Here we had two answers, two versions. One version was the sectarian and dogmatic answer that was given, for example, by the forces of the Greek Communist Party and also by an elitist part of anarchist groups that denounced the movement of the square as an apolitical expression of the lumpenized popular and middle classes that used to support the mainstream political parties in the past and were now trying to express their frustration. There was a second response that came by Syriza and another part, for example, of the anti-authoritarian movement. And this was that this seems to be an apolitical movement, yes. We can see thousands of people that really express their frustration because they used to vote for the mainstream parties and now feel deceived. But what is the role of a revolutionary when we finally see the mobility of the masses? Is it to stay home and denounce this mobility? After 35 years of a devastating cultural and political hegemony of the neoliberal concept of individualism and the individual concept of the neoliberal concept of competitiveness among people and among countries, suddenly we had the emergence of a new kind of social reaction. So in this crucial moment we chose the second version. We chose to join this movement and not try to manipulate it. We didn't carry Syriza flags in Syntagma Square in Athens. We discussed with our membership, with our organized members, and we decided that in every square of the country that people gathered spontaneously, our members will be there with their physical presence, of course with the political identity we have collectively constructed in our 20 years of existence as an alternative left, and not only as Syriza, and will participate in the procedures of the movement as a, in a way as the one that I tried to describe before with the metaphor, as a fish that swims in the water. And this means that when popular assemblies were organized in the squares of Greece, we didn't have the anxiety of approving 100% of our political framework of demands. We had the anxiety to interact with what we call ordinary people. People who decided to break their silence and express their agony, their frustration, and their aspirations at the same moment. One of the main reasons that the Golden Dawn, I will tell more later, but one of the main, I would like to keep this element. One of the main reasons that the Golden Dawn simply entered the parliament and did not explode to 10 or 15% in the elections was the fact was because of the battle we did against the infiltration of nationalists in the movement of the squares. If the left was absent, if the left in its totality followed the mentality of the rejection of this movement, then the attempt of the nationalists to manipulate the movement would have been completely successful. In contrast, we managed to marginalize them. There were popular assemblies of 3,000 and 5,000 of people every evening on Syntagma Square and the rest of the squares of Greece. In these popular assemblies, after the first days, nationalists did not feel confident to speak because they realized that it would be very difficult to change the agenda that the vast majority of the people that spoke in the assemblies was formulating. And I have to say that we believe that our help in this direction has been really important. Because as I told you, the question was not to manipulate the dialogue, but the question was through the interaction, on an equal basis with the individualities that joined this movement, to try to contaminate, as the anti-global movement said, it's a nice word, to contaminate the public discourse in the battle of ideas. And this was, we believe it was up to a great extent, it was a successful fight we gave. This approach that I have been trying to describe to you reflects more or less our approach towards the question of establishing the first left government in the contemporary political history of Greece. There's a usual question that we receive from journalists or from comrades and friends from other countries. How far are you willing and how far are you capable of going if you win? The answer is not easy. It's a very complex answer that has to do with a lot of variables. But the answer is always the same. And we got some lessons from, for example, the Venezuelan process from 98 until today. This question will be answered and will continue to be answered by one specific thing. By the level of energy and participation and mobility and intervention of the masses, of the basis of our society, into this very difficult process of elaborating smaller and deeper changes and transformations in an economic, in a political, in a constitutional, in a social level. And this battle is very hard because the fact that Syriza has already had 27% in the second snap election since the 17th of June does not mean that we have managed to overcome the crisis of political representation and the mistrust of the vast majority of people towards political parties. We might even win the next elections with the vote of even more people, but this will not mean that this majority of voters that will give us their vote will trust us at the same moment. Many of them will vote us because they feel that there's nothing else to try. This does not mean that they trust us automatically. And this is the historical question for the left in Greece, I hope in other countries very soon, at this historical period. How we will be able to transform theoretical analysis and proposals that have been written on paper until today into a concrete political program with one basic aim. And this is connected to the question of a combination of representative and direct democracy, and on the question of if it's necessary to build political instruments and political subjects. The usefulness of the political subject is defined by answering the question if this political subject is able to concentrate the political demands and the political aspirations that come out from the mobility of the masses, that come out from the emerging social movements and resistances, and concretize them in political demands that will be expressed in the central institutional level as well. There can be social movements and massive demonstrations that will continue to kick out the repressive governments. But they have to find the necessary channels not only to kick out the bad governments, but also find the ways and the methodologies and the tools to replace them with something that reflects their own vision for their own lives. The social movements are the engine for social transformation. I wouldn't say that we also need a driver, because we are not of this mentality. We don't need a driver. We need multiple drivers so that we manage to influence history and to take history to the direction we want to take it. This is an agony. This is a question that we are trying to answer also through the creation of our concrete governmental program, to link it with another question you made, another comment. What we believe about what we call our strategic aim, which in terms of slogan is the socialism of the 21st century, a socialism with freedom and democracy, because we are a political space that has recognized commonly, despite our different traditions, that socialism is not socialism if it's not characterized by deep democratic institutions and popular participation and freedom of expression. What we believe about this kind of strategic vision, strategic target, is that it is not an ending point. It is not the final destination. It is a continuous process of experimentation and transformations. We do not want to establish a left government to change the faces or the name of the ruling party. If we do this, this can happen actually, but if we do this, we will collapse very fast. Because we might not face military dictatorships in this historical period in Europe, but we're facing an opponent which is very powerful and far more complex than the military dictatorships we faced in previous decades. In Greece, we call it usually the triangle of sin, the sinful triangle. It consists of large business conglomerates who own, for example, construction companies, and at the same time are major stockholders of the private banking system, and at the same time they are the main political supporters of the traditional political establishment. So this interaction has created corruption and has created the clientelist state that Greece has seen after the fall of the military dictatorship in 1974. So the question is, many opponents, ideological opponents, accuse us of being lovers of the corrupted state, the corrupted dominance of the public sector that we have seen in the previous decades failing and reproducing inequalities and reproducing economic scandals and failing to achieve transparency. No, this is not our approach. The question of conquering the state, of really conquering the state, does not end if you win elections. The question is, after the electoral victory, how will you be able, through your intervention in the state, to demolish the state and bring a different state in its place? And this also has to do with the articulation of representative and direct democratic institutions, methodologies and practices. The memorandums of the Greek government with the Troika have terminated collective bargaining and collective contracts. It is our priority to restore them, not only to have more, to have a stronger workers' movement, but at the same time to restore democracy in the workplace. The tax system is anti-constitutional, because the Greek constitution says that each Greek citizen should contribute to the annual tax revenue according to his or her annual income, proportionally. What is happening all the previous decades is that the rich do not pay taxes. The large Greek ship owners, who own the second biggest commercial fleet of ships globally, have about 70 or 75 different tax exemptions. And at the same time, the popular and the middle classes of our country have been losing their houses because of the unbelievable imposition of continuous new taxes, like the property taxes, and of course the dominance of the private banks, which uncontrollably blackmail the people and confiscate their houses. This is also a question of democracy. The safeguarding of the universal access of the citizens of a country to basic social services, basic social goods, is not only a material question. It is a basic question of democracy. The exercising of referendums is a question of democracy. The last referendum we had in Greece was in 1974, when the military dictatorship collapsed, and it was on the question of the abolishment of royalty. After that, we have never had a referendum again. The redirection of public spending into public investments that create jobs, restore the quality of life of people, improve environmental and material conditions for our society is also a question of democracy. If you manage to feed the people, I want to make it very simple. If you manage to feed the people, you have a necessary precondition then to discuss with the people about their social and political activation. If you want to keep your society alert to control you all the time, they don't have to be anxious if they will have food tomorrow morning. And this is a basic achievement that characterizes, it plays a central role in our program. This is a way to reach hegemony, by changing the daily paradigm, by democratizing institutions, but also by inventing new institutions, by inventing new processes of integrating ordinary people in the building of a different set of values and a different system. It is not an easy task to overcome 35 years, as I told you, of cultural and political hegemony of neoliberal fundamentalism. It is a continuous task. It is a continuous duty that cannot be answered only once. It has to be reaffirmed every day. And starting from now, not from the day we will managed to formulate a left government. That's why, for example, we have put all our technical and human resources in the building of networks of practical solidarity, as we call them. These are local initiatives that spread all around the country. You will never see a flag of Syriza in these local initiatives. You will never see somebody speaking on TV on behalf of these movements with a subtitle representative of Syriza in the movement. Never. You will only see Syriza members being the physical protagonists for the construction of these networks. And to be very clear, what is this? It is a process of material support to the people, but at the same time a process of constructing a different paradigm. Socialism leaving its small footsteps today. Socialism. The alternative perspective, let's say, very vaguely, leaving some first footprints from today. The main slogan in these networks of solidarity is that you cannot overcome collective problems with personal solutions. Losing your home today is not a personal problem in Greece. It is a collective problem. We have 24,000 homeless people in Athens. Having access to basic medicine and vaccination is not a personal problem anymore. We have the reappearance of infectious diseases that disappeared in the 50s and 60s because children of the primary school and the kindergarten do not have access to free vaccination. Being unemployed is not a personal problem anymore. Well, it has never been, but now people are realizing this. We have a general unemployment rate that approaches 30%, and a youth unemployment rate up to the age of 24 that reaches 56%. These are collective problems. And the culture we are trying to build through the networks of solidarity from today is that they can be resolved only through collective action. And this means social healthcare centers, social drugstores, collective cooking and distribution of food, direct exchange of material goods between the producers, for example, the farmers, and the consumers without the mediation of money or in very cheap prices, because the high costs of basic goods has been a very big problem in Greece, reproduced by what we call the mediators of the market. So it's a logic against the mainstream market logic. The farmers are coming to the center of Athens, from all over the country, to the center of Thessaloniki. Urban populations come in direct contact with the farmers. Not only when they go to their village for vacation, but now for practical reasons, on a daily basis. They interact problems which they thought in the past that were of a different nature, but actually they are problems of the same nature. And all this work is based on thousands of volunteers, with no flags of Syriza, I repeat. Last two things. First, a comment of the battle on the nation state. Since the beginning of the crisis, we acknowledge the crisis as a global and European structural systemic crisis of neoliberal capitalism, and not a confrontation between nations. This crisis is not a confrontation between the workers of Germany and the workers of Greece, no matter if the main discourse of the neoliberals wishes to present it like this in order to win hegemony against the peoples, for example, of the European South or Ireland, who have suddenly become the scapegoats. In the previous decade, they were the Celtic tiger of growth, or the Greek miracle of growth, or the Slovenian example of growth. But these examples have collapsed with a lot of noise. So now they had to find the legitimization for the super austerity programs. And the best rhetoric was the rhetoric of Bild, the yellow conservative tabloid in Germany, that lazy Greeks are spending the money ruthlessly of the northern European taxpayers, and they do not pay their taxes, they do not work. Greek workers, according to Eurostat, work for more working hours per year than German workers. So this is not a confrontation among states. Since the beginning, the European left, which is a very useful tool which we are using for the necessary European coordination of struggles and political demands, the party of the European left, which concentrates 39 parties from different EU, but also in general European countries, we insisted that this is not a national confrontation. This is the hardest, the most violent class war, class confrontation that European societies have experienced after the end of World War II. In the years of the fantastic discipline of the German economy and the big growth of German economy, the salaries of German workers have been frozen for the last decade. In Scandinavia, on the excuse of the crisis, they are now destroying the social state, the welfare state. Our societies, even in the countries that thought that they would never be affected, but are now being affected, clearly now start to realize what was the real question behind the excuse of the crisis and the explosion of public debts. And the real question was a violent redistribution of wealth from bottom to top. So this is the main question to be answered by internationalized struggles. A very massive and well-coordinated European fight for a radical change in the balance of power in a European level, not only in the national state. If Syriza wins in Europe, but no leaf of a tree moves in another European country, then we would very easily become, for a while, because eventually we will be defeated in this case, but for a while we can become the sympathetic or the interesting village of Asterix and Obelix. Some crazy guys in a corner of Europe that in a way won the government and they are saying crazy things in the European Union meetings. This is why it is very crucial that the people of all the countries where the material conditions created by the austerity programs are destroying these societies, these people have reacted. The situation, for example, in Portugal, in Spain, it is very important, the fact that the social movements are alive, they are becoming massive, and at the same time, the political left, which swims like a fish in the water in this movement, sees its electoral influence to improve magnificently in the last months, at least in the opinion polls, comparing to the last national elections in 2011 in the case of the two countries, gives us a very optimistic perspective. But of course, this is not enough. I came here because I realized that 23 years after the silence of the cemetery, in a country that experienced the so-called real socialist period, its people are reacting. And I came here to see what's going on. Because for us it is very important that in another European Union state, when it was not predictable, it was not expected, but still the people have reacted. Because they realized what I was telling you before. That something is wrong with the main strategy. That the big promise of prosperity was a balloon that exploded with a lot of noise. And that's why I am here, to interact with all the alive forces that are now beginning to think in a different way and are thinking of how to make it more efficient and more victorious. The last question about Golden Dawn. Golden Dawn was voted not only because of its racist and xenophobic rhetoric. First of all, a comment on this. Racist and xenophobic rhetoric became legitimized and became a part of the mainstream political discourse in Greece during the government of the Socialist Party, of the Social Democrats. The Social Democratic Minister of Health ordered the Greek police 2 years ago to publish photos of immigrant prostitutes with no papers who were infected by HIV for reasons of public safety, so that the poor Greek men that went with these women, who were obviously at the same time drug addicts and extremely marginalized, should be immediately tested for HIV. It's the construction, the symbolic and the pragmatic construction of the alien infectious enemy. This gave the basis, the fertile ground for the development of the Golden Dawn on one hand. On the other hand, yes, a part of the people who reacted against the mainstream political establishment were convinced by this murderous gang that it is actually an anti-systemic force, especially younger people, because Golden Dawn had a good electoral performance among young voters. Young voters, their vote has been influenced by the educational system and the lack of real historical knowledge that it offers about what happened in the Nazi period, about what happened in the military dictatorship period in Greece. And it also came because if the commercialized ideal for a man is to have a lot of muscles and be able to go out in the street and beat everyone who challenges him, then it's very easy when you see a party of bodybuilders and security guards of nightclubs to be offering a sense of security in the ghettos of the big cities, for example, and it's very easy to be influenced. How to win back these people? Because nobody believes that suddenly we have 6% in the elections and now 9 to 10% in the opinion polls of Greek people who suddenly became fascists. This is nonsense. The voters of the Golden Dawn have an average profile of low-educated people of the suppressed social classes, popular and middle classes, that express their frustration in this direction. This is another role of our networks of solidarity. Two of the basic sentiments that the crisis created is frustration and at the same time devastation of the people. These are conservative feelings. And these are the butter on the bread of the Golden Dawn. If you don't manage through offering an alternative paradigm of collective action and collective confrontation of problems that somebody believed that until now they were personal, then they would turn to the easiest solution. They would turn to those guys who express very lively this frustration and angry determination to demolish the political traitors. So the question is, through your contact with these popular classes of people, through your daily activities in the neighborhoods, and when you assume the responsibility of a government through your social and economic projects and policies to improve the material conditions of their life, so that they don't feel devastated anymore, and at the same time to start introducing a new set of values, a counter-hegemonic set of values for these people to be trained, because the state has traditionally had an educational role. Legislation plays an educational role in the middle of a very conservative Christian Orthodox society. The introduction of civil marriage in the 80s, despite the reactions of the Orthodox Church, played an educational role, a cultural role. The majority of couples today marry through a civil marriage. Just a very small example. So this is the duty. These are the main questions that need to be answered in order to avoid the victory of cannibalism, because the Golden Dawn is not only a fascist gang in theory, it is a practical expression of social cannibalism. And this is another big task that I hope we will face also from the position of a left government quite soon. I would like to refer a bit on the danger of the integration of social movements by the mainstream. In some cases, the interference of left or communist or progressive political parties has led to this integration, unfortunately. But in other cases, where even left parties did not exist, this integration was even bigger and faster. So, it is always a question, I believe, of being able to participate in a movement and continuously stimulating a movement to produce new ideas and practices, and mainly to produce multiple repertoires of expression, so that it becomes inclusive for all the different approaches that exist and are alive and wish to react. And on another level, we have had cases like, for example, in some cases of the Arab Spring, where actually one of the problems proved to be the inability of the various small fragmented left political forces, or the inexistence of these forces even, to construct such political subjects that would be able to express the real demands, the radical demands, the radical agendas, for the emancipatory agendas, the demands for a radical democratization and the establishment of basic social rights, of or advanced social rights, to incorporate them into a revolutionary, a radical program of fight. And now people in Egypt are frustrated and are trying to react again, but now it's even more difficult. So, to tell you the truth, the creation of political parties is not a fetish. We are not fetishists. As we are not, we don't have a fetish with becoming the government, just for becoming the government. I don't have a fetish on the question of creating a political party. A political party of the left is not created, it does not survive, it does not develop under a metaphysical concept. It is created in times that some people believe that it should express their own needs. Some left parties have been created out of reasons that did not have to do with these questions, but then they disappeared. And then after the creation of the left political subject, in order to express these needs and these demands, it is always an open question if the political subject will continue to serve and offer this social availability as a political subject, to express these aspirations continuously and fight for them. If a political party is created by masses of people and then it detaches itself from the masses and follows an elitist methodology and an elitist discourse of believing that it has invented the perfect political program by itself, then it's bound to fail. And all these kinds of left parties that followed this path have dramatically failed. If we have the illusion that our participation, massive participation as a political party in the social movements, will automatically mean that the social movements will be behind us on whatever we choose to do in the next step, we will end up like the Italian left, which is very bitter for us. The forces that protagonized in the anti-global movement in terms of the political left, the Italians that became in the beginning of the last decade a political and methodological inspiration for the Greek radical left, but actually made choices without calculating and investing on the continuous interrelation with the movements. They joined the Prodi government. They had the illusion that with an advanced but not hegemonic electoral percentage in the election, 7-8%, that could join a center-left government, while they knew that the social democracy that Prodi represented was actually an adapted social liberal program that Tony Blair and Gerhard Schröder dreamt and actually exercised in their own countries. So if in any moment of this course of the political subject you create, you detach yourself and your collectivity from the reasons for which you were created, you are bound to fail. And this has to do with your question about the fact that maybe our unity has been based on the external other, and actually the easiest way to get destroyed is to be elected as a government, because we will pass from the simple no to neoliberalism, which is not very simple, it's an achievement of the movement to reach this point, to a kind of yes to something else. Then we have the other thing that we also must admit, if we're talking about the need for the existence of left, radical, progressive political forces. What is the necessity of the existence of a left political party, for example, in this tragic but also historic political period for the Greek people, historic period for the Greek society and the oppressed social classes? There were some, even some leftists that discussed among them after the elections in June, when we lost only by 2% margin by the right wing, that thank God we didn't win the elections because we were not ready to govern. And now we will have more time to prepare. Yeah, we might have more time to prepare, but what is the necessity of existing as a left, and what is the necessity of fighting to transform your society if you say, thank God, while unemployment, youth unemployment is 56%, thank God we didn't win, because now we have 5 or 6 months ahead of us to get better prepared in a programmatic and in an organizational level. This is what in French they call gauchisme. It's the detachment from the urgencies that the society itself poses and the reality itself poses. I fully disagree with this approach. Were we ready last June? We will never be ready enough. Because you never know what you're going to face, because the enemy is so complex that you never know what you will find ahead of you in this continuous project of smaller and bigger transformation. But on the other hand, the fact that you will never be ready enough does not mean that you will abandon this project. What's the meaning of the existence of a political subject that advocates for human emancipation and liberation of humans from exploitation, if it says that I will not assume responsibility for a while, you can get destroyed for another year, and then maybe I will be in a better shape? If we fail and we get destroyed, at least we will have tried. Come on. The people have tried enough to get rid of the forces that destroyed their lives. Now we should do something following the aspirations of these tribes, of these people. If we fail, we will get destroyed, yes. I told you, I don't believe that left parties remain in life eternally in a metaphysical way. But we should try. The easiest way to be successful is to never try. Okay? But when the basic salary will become 55 euros per month, then you will not even have the chance to be successful without doing anything, because we will die of natural death. Okay.
Famine is natural.
What?
Famine is natural. Yes.
Mistakes that have been done. We are human beings and we have been under the neoliberal hegemony and under the hegemony of individualism for almost 4 decades now. The battle for human emancipation and liberation from prejudices and the hegemony of the neoliberal lifestyle and the neoliberal way of thinking starts from the internal level of the political subject of the left. The fact that we are the party with the most female MPs in the parliament does not mean that we have achieved full equality in our party. Still, our women MPs are about 35% to 38%. The fact that we officially support the legalization of gay marriage, for example, does not mean that we have fully comprehended and succeeded in making this opinion a part, a crucial part of our fundamental set of values throughout all our members. It needs a continuous struggle inside the political subject to change the mentalities of people who have been subject to the attack of the opponent and must be step by step emancipated through the collective discussion and through the collective practices. If we let subjectivities and egoistic approaches and elitist approaches prevail, then we are led to crisis and to a loss of our social utility. We have faced such phenomena, if we're talking about mistakes. In some cases, we were in great danger because we let such phenomena to escalate internally, but fortunately, until now, we have managed to cope with them. The international perspective, out of the national level, I told you before that both in the level of movements and in the level of political coordination, we are pretty much orientated, at least on the European level, as we acknowledge the European Union as a geopolitical field of struggle for greater social transformations. And that's why, for example, although we are EU critics and we say that the crisis is a structural crisis of the way that the European Union and the Eurozone have been constructed, we don't advocate in favor of the dissolution of the European Union, but what we're trying to say is that we need a well-coordinated, class-orientated, massive movement of resistance in a European level in order to change the balance of power and reinforce the idea of refounding the European Union on a completely different set of values. In practical terms and within the movements, one last recent initiative that we participate is the so-called European Alter Summit. And actually, I would like to announce that in the first weekend of June, the first massive Alter Summit, after some meetings of getting to know each other in the previous months, will be organized in Athens. I think from the 3rd to the 7th of June, but I'm not sure. And we are hoping to attract about 2,000 to 3,000 of foreign guests. And this came as a need to revive our meeting places, our meeting initiatives, our coming together initiatives that successfully worked in the past, at least for some years, for example, in the social forum process. And apart from that, as I spoke to you about the networks of solidarity, we are now trying to internationalize the appeal of these networks. We have made an umbrella platform to coordinate these local initiatives, which is called Solidarity for All. And if you visit solidarityforall.gr, you can find appeals for international solidarity in many different foreign languages, English, German, French, and you can get a better picture of what we are doing through these networks. I still believe that although fascism cannot only be faced from above. I still firmly believe what I said in my intervention in the beginning, that the transformation of the state can and has to play an educational role in establishing counterexamples, a new paradigm. And I believe that this is a contribution that the state can play in the fight against Nazism, neo-Nazism. Through reforms in the educational system, through a continuous attempt of deepening public control and public interference in the decision making, and through various procedures that will try to overcome the crisis of political representation. And this is to restore the trust of the people towards, not in any kind of government, but in this alternative left government that we wish to establish, and also to restore their faith that with their intervention they can influence the course of things, not only on the economic level to pay for a democratic tax system, but also in the level of deepening democracy. And I believe that this educational role can and must be played by the state ruled by a left government in Greece, in order also to confront more efficiently the other opponents and not only the content owner, like, for example, the media system.